I convey greetings from the Governing Council of the East African Law Society. We are partners of Lawyers Hub, and beyond this conference, the last 2 years we've been working to accelerate the learning in technology for lawyers. As we speak today, we have to remember that we are standing on the shoulders of the fourth industrial revolution. If you forget this, then technology is not going to make any meaning to you. From today, and over the coming years, probably over the next 50 years, we are not going to witness any revolution away from the fourth industrial revolution across sectors, education, medicine, production, in any way. So those who don't follow the dictates of the fourth industrial revolution are likely to be disrupted and disrupted in a very big way. If we recall, for the history students and for all of us, they've been three phases of industrial revolution in the history of mankind. The first one was mainly powered by steam, and that's where we think of steamships, production using hot water, and it was real production. It was a revolution because, remember, that was only succeeding Stone Age era, where man was only able to make fire and a bit of sharp objects for hunting. Following the first industrial revolution, man ventured into the second industrial revolution, which was powered by electricity. And this was the first era that man realized mass production with machines which were powered by electric current. That was not enough. Technology soon came in to power the third industrial revolution. And most of us in this room have been experiencing the phase of the third industrial revolution. Now, you might ask yourself, then what is this fourth one? This fourth one is extreme technology. You already hear about medical groundbreaking research where, you know, medical donation of organs and all that is coming to be a thing of the past. Man is now developing bionic organs, very minute heart, livers that can be carried everywhere. We are already thinking about extreme modes of transport. Air travel is going to be a thing of the past. In fact, people like Elon Musk are already thinking that, where should you confine yourself into some aluminium tube? This is so risky. Yet the builders of airlines have always thought it's the safest mode of transport. Somebody's already start thinking of something extreme. Somebody's already thinking that you don't need to be carrying phones around you. You could actually have an inbuilt chip to be installed at birth, and that should be able to help you communicate throughout your life. And important even for human survival, in the next future, you don't really need to worry about being pricked for samples to be taken for testing. That small cameras by a flick will be able to tell us your medical history and what you are suffering from. Ladies and gentlemen, those are just the highlights of where the fourth industrial revolution will take us. Allow me to speak briefly about the economic angles of the fourth industrial revolution, because for man, without economics, then technology is useless. And I always want us to think about it ourselves. What are the economic values that this technology is going to give us? As young people, if you are going to have an idea or a proposal you want to share with a possible investor and you can't present an economic value to it, that idea is dead on arrival. The use of technology or the fourth industrial revolution has already been shown to be in a position to accelerate the realization of sustainable development goals. I've just given examples of equality, gender equality. That's one of the sustainable development goals that use of technology could actually accelerate that. But importantly, there's need for redistribution of the global wealth. The global south, sadly, where we are sitting today, remains the poorest part of the world. And this can be seen even in the face of the adversity that is facing the world, the coronavirus pandemic. Africa is not connected to the world. And that's what we have to think about when we are in this room. How often is it easy for you to travel from one part of Africa to the next? Forget about one part of Africa to the world. Think about this country alone. How is it easy is it to move from, say, Nairobi City, where we are, to the border with Uganda? Yet Uganda is our biggest trading partner in the world. How easy is it? How many flights connect Kenya to our biggest trading partner in a day? How many vehicles do that? On average, it will take you 11 hours to travel between the capital city of Kenya and the capital city of Uganda, if we take the average of cars and air travel. That is how scarcely Africa is connected to the world. And I'll share with you official statistics by International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO. It says in 2018, when the last statistics were published, 4.3 billion people traveled across the world by air. Of course, there's an insignificant statistics that traveled by water, but most of international travel now is by air. Out of that 4.3 billion, 805 million people originated and traveled to the European Union. And the country, one country called Vietnam, managed to share 47 million of that. What did Africa do? Across Africa, how many countries? I think 55 now. Only 65 million people traveled or originated from Africa by air in 2018. That represents 2.1% of the 4.3 billion that traveled the world. And now you'd understand why we need a policy rethink on our migration and why technology comes in. You've already heard about the African Continental Free Trade Area, which promises to revolutionize how the economy of Africa will be and how trade in Africa will be carried out. It is supported by the protocol on free movement of people, right of residence, and right of establishment. Without well-thought policies, that protocol is dead on arrival. And I say this because I work at the center of the East African community. For the last over 10 years, the East African community has had the Common Markets Protocol, which guarantees free movement of people, of goods, of services, and of capital. Yet realization has been the hardest thing in this region. People are still required to carry paper passports when moving across the borders. The simplification by Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania to require that you can still carry your national ID to cross does not make it better, because it's still being powered by an archaic way of moving, meaning without a paper, you are still not able to make your movement. I think technology can come in somewhere to make this easy. Why do I say this? I think we don't need to be moving around with paper, you know, paper identification, when already the digital space is just begging for utilization. I don't think there's need to be walking across embassies looking for visas at costly rates. 2 weeks ago, I had a test of my medicine, when I tried accessing the visa of Ivory Coast from Nairobi, and the average cost of the visa kept on accelerating based on the time of application was $175 per person. $175 on visa to enable me just walk into an African country for 2 or 3 days. It gets worse even when you look at countries like Ethiopia, which are hosting the largest diplomatic institutions in Africa, where you have to spend an average of $100 to access a visa when you are going to visit the AU or the United Nations offices in Addis Ababa. I believe if we think through technology, then we are able to simplify some of this to the better of Africa. But it's not going to be easy. We have to think about data protection in the course of movement. If I'm already enjoying well data protection in my country, I would want to continue enjoying that when I move into another African country. How do we ensure policies that guarantee uniform protection? When I do business in another African country, I would want to be comfortable that my earnings can easily be transferred back to my country without being asked to convert into what? My friend from Rubé and Company in Burundi will tell you that the past few years, thank you, accessing dollars in Burundi has become so much of a problem that if you did your earnings in Burundi, you might as well be forced to carry them in the Burundian local currency to your country. What are you going to do with them? That transferability will have to be enabled by use of technology. Importantly, if I'm working in another country and I'm entitled to social security, I would want to be guaranteed that that is transferable back to my country when I'm done with my work. And I believe at the end of the day, we should be able to think through how technology could be used to simplify this. Thank you.